Good morning. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord, for he comes. He comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the people in his faithfulness. We are gathered here today to praise the Lord, to bring praise to our God who is coming. This is an Advent Sunday, so we're celebrating the coming of God. The coming of the Lord Jesus, this first coming, but also looking forward to his second coming and thinking about that coming as well. Well, if you will stand or kneel, we're going to begin this service with prayer. First, I'll lead us in prayer, and then we will confess our sins together. You'll find that prayer there in the bulletin. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. And let's confess our sins together in those words you find there in the bulletin. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name, amen. Now let each of us come before the face of the Lord, confessing our own sins. We're going to have a minute of silence where you may confess your sins to God in your own heart. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of God.
If you'll remain standing, let's take out the red hymnal and turn to page 194. Page 194. O come, Emmanuel.
Emmanuel shall come to thee, O
This is not in your bulletin, but if you will look, before you turn to Psalm 72, will you turn to Luke chapter 1? What I'm going to do is read for you the passage that I'm going to preach from this morning. I'm going to read it now because I'm really going to focus in on just one or two verses in the sermon, but I want you to hear the whole thing. And then I want you to hear Psalm 72 in light of this passage, and I want you to hear Isaiah 11 that the Anons are going to read in light of this passage as well. So Luke chapter 1 and verse 39, where we left off last week in this account of Luke chapter 1. We read the account of Gabriel appearing to Mary last week. Verse 39, at that time Mary got ready and she hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth, her relative. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb. This is the baby in Elizabeth's womb, John. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. So what she's about to say is given to her by the Spirit. It's prophetic. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you, Mary, among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greetings reached my ears, the baby in my womb, John the Baptist, leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." So what Mary heard from Gabriel, she has believed in faith. She has received that word and believed it. Blessed is she. And she is whole, she has within her Jesus. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one, God, has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers." That's the end of Mary's song. And then Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. Will you turn to Psalm 72? We're going to read this together. Turn to Psalm 72. Now, Psalm 72, while we're reading it together, we're going to alternate. I'm going to begin with the odd verses, and you respond with the even verses, all together, reading it together. This is a psalm about the king, but on a grander scale, it's about the Messiah. The king, of course, this is about the king, but the prophets, there's a prophecy here of a greater king, the Messiah, who will come. And what I want you to note in this passage and in the one that Aaron and Taylor are about to read from Isaiah, note the mission of the Messiah. Note what these two passages actually say the Messiah is going to do. It may not be what we typically think of the ordinary things that come to mind. Okay, Psalm 72. "Endow the king with your justice, O God, the royal son with your righteousness. The mountains will bring prosperity to the people, the hills the fruit of righteousness.
He will defend the afflicted among the people and save the children of the needy. He will crush the oppressor.
He will endure as long as the sun, as long as the moon, through all generations.
He will be like rain falling on a mown field, like showers watering the earth.
In his days, the righteous will flourish. Prosperity will abound till the moon is no more.
He will rule from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth.
The desert tribes will bow before him, and his enemies will lick the dust.
The kings of Tarshish and of distant shores will bring tribute to him. The kings of Sheba and Seba will present him gifts.
All kings will bow down to him, and all nations will serve him.
For he will deliver the needy who cry out, the afflicted who have no one to help.
He will take pity on the weak and the needy and save the needy from death.
He will rescue them from oppression and violence, for precious is their blood in his sight.
Long may he live, may gold from Sheba be given him, may people ever pray for him and bless him all day long.
Let grain abound throughout the land, on the tops of the hills may it sway. Let its fruit flourish like Lebanon, let it thrive like the grass of the field.
May his name endure forever, may it continue as long as the sun. All nations will be blessed through him, and they will call him blessed.
Praise be to the Lord God, the God of Israel, who alone does marvelous deeds.
Praise be to his glorious name forever. May the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen.
This concludes
you can say
the
it.
Prayer of David, son of Jesse.
You hesitated on that one, huh? Okay. This is the word of the Lord.
This is Isaiah 11, 1 through 10. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of power, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice, he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together. And the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the hole of the cobra, and the young child put his hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his place of rest will be glorious.
Let us pray. O come, O branch of Jesse's stem, unto your own and rescue them. From depths of hell your people save, and give them victory o'er the grave. O come, O King of nations bind, and one of the hearts of all mankind, bid all our sad divisions cease, and be yourself our King of peace. Amen.
If you will stand now, let's sing together, Hail to the Lord's Anointed. The lyrics are in your bulletin.
So turn back to Luke chapter 1, what I read already for you. There's a lot in here, and I decided to focus in on probably the strangest part of the section we read. I thought maybe it'd be a part that wasn't well understood, so we'll focus in on that today to maybe help us understand something that maybe some of us haven't quite figured out. So that is, we're going to look at begin with verse 51, 52, and 53 will be our focus. 51, 52, and 53. Before we look at that, let's pray. Father in heaven, we ask that you would be with your people now as we consider this portion of your word and a few other portions of your word that we've already looked at today. Teach us, we ask. We ask that your Holy Spirit would be at work in our hearts. Father, illuminate us. Give us light that we don't have. Our minds need truth, maybe that we haven't fully understood. We need you to, even if we do understand these things, we need you to show us what it means for us. We need to hear the encouragement of it. We need to hear the challenge of it. Father, build up our faith, build up our hope, build up our joy, build up our love. Be at work in us by your word and spirit now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, there's certain things that in American Christianity, or what I mean by that is just, you know, every area of the Christian faith has certain emphases and certain ways of talking. But there's certain things about the way Christianity is talked about in America that bug me a lot. They frustrate me. And I'm not talking about what Jesus taught. I'm talking about sort of a pop version of Christianity. I'm talking about like the version that sort of is what is on the most simple level talked about in the sort of a popular version. Sometimes you have to dig a little bit deeper to get into what the Word of God actually says, because sometimes what you'll hear from people who are true Christians and real Christians and do understand much of the Word, but they may say things or they might assume things that they're missing a lot of pieces. And so one of the things that really bugs me, that I often hear, one of the things that bugs me and bugs many people, of course, is this. On the last day when Christ returns, people will be, who believe in Jesus will be, how should I put this? People who believe in Jesus, there won't be any talk about their lives or what they did or what has gone before. Let me put it this way. This will be a way to put it. If a Christian harmed somebody else during his life or during her life, that will not be addressed by God. That's forgiven by God. And he will go scot-free and just go into heaven, and there will be no justice for the thing that he did. That's just not true. That's not what the Bible teaches. Now, the Bible also teaches that we're forgiven of our sins. The Bible also teaches that in Christ those sins are forgiven and God loves us. And if we have faith in Jesus, we are loved by God, we are forgiven. But the Bible very clearly teaches that there will be a day of reckoning for Christians as well. That there will be a day of reckoning. If a Christian harmed other people, it's not true. This pop version of Christianity says when you get to the judgment day, it'll just be like, you get to the judgment day and God will just say, you believe in Jesus, come on in. You don't have to worry about anybody you ever hurt, anybody you ever harmed, any injustice or cruelty or anything you were ever involved in before. None of that matters anymore. Just come on in. You're scot-free. It's never to be talked about. That's not what the scriptures teach. They don't teach that. That's not the way the scriptures present the last judgment day. But that's sort of a pop version of Christianity. When you get to that day, a popular version, a simplistic version, we could say it that way, that leaves out whole sections of the Bible, whole sections of what the Bible teaches. And what if that was true, and this is what bugs me about it, it bugged me about it before I knew that the Bible taught other words, because what bugs me about it, and what may bug you about it as well, is that sounds like heaven is just as unfair as the world. Now, is that what it's going to be, that heaven's unfair? But you put your faith in Jesus, and so we're not going to talk about any of that. Don't worry about any of that. Just come on in. It's all taken care of. So in this world, power, you know, people who have power can get things and get out of things because they have power. But in heaven, you can get out of things by believing in Jesus. So heaven's unfair too. This world's unfair because of power, and heaven's unfair because if you believe in Jesus, you get out of things. You don't ever have to answer for things. It's not true. You answer. The Bible clearly teaches that you answer. Now, that does not erase the good news. It doesn't erase the good news of the fact that there's forgiveness for your sins. We have to believe that too. That's what the Scripture also teaches. But that's not what the Bible teaches, that on that day everything is forgotten. Everything you did in your life is erased. Look with me at verse 51 here. At verse 51. So this is Mary, and Mary is filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, Mary has written this part of the Bible, you know, so a lady has written part of the Bible, and she has, she was inspired by the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit. She is prophesying the very words of God. God has filled, as he filled up Elizabeth earlier, Mary has been filled up with the Holy Spirit, and she is prophesying. She is speaking the truth about God, speaking the truth about the Son within her, the Son in her own womb at this moment. We don't know how old he is at this point, but the Son in her own womb that she is carrying, she is prophesying about that Son. And these three verses that we're going to look at are what we call, they are prophecies, but what prophets often did, it's in the past tense. You notice that? It's talking about God did this, God did that, but that's what prophets often did in the Old Testament and continue to do in the New Testament, which is they will speak of, they're prophesying something that God is going to do, prophesying something a Messiah is going to do, and yet they speak of it in past tense as if it's already happened. Prophets would talk that way. They'll be like, God did this, God did this. And what they mean is, I'm prophesying that God is going to do this. And it's as sure as if it's already done. It is certain. It's a prophetic past. It's a prophetic aorist. It is something that is already sure, already secure. And so this is what Mary is saying that her son Jesus is going to do. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. Now, those are sort of strange verses in the middle of, it's a strange Christmas carol, you know, it's a strange Christmas song to hear those kinds of words. That's not what you typically associate with Christmas or with Advent, but it is what the prophecies associate with Advent. We read some of them this morning. We heard the Psalms. We heard Isaiah. We'll look back at them in a minute, and I'll remind you of that. But this is Mary speaking about her son, saying this is what her son could do. And we're not going to get into all the details of this, but the general idea is this. When the Messiah finally comes, and when he sets up his kingdom, there are two groups. There are two groups here that are being thought about. The powerful who harm the weak, and the weak who are harmed by the powerful. That's what this language is about. Especially if it's probably most simply laid out there for you in verse 52. He has brought down rulers from their throne. It's not just like God's just going to topple kings randomly. That's not the idea. The idea, when you bring it with the second part of it, is he has brought down rulers from their thrones, and he has lifted up the humble. That means the humble in their estate. So it's basically saying, God, those who are on top, the powerful, who are hurting those underneath them, he's going to bring them down. And those who are on the bottom, who are being hurt by the powerful, he is going to lift them up. He's going to help them. This is what the Messiah is going to do. We saw the same thing in the Psalms and Isaiah this morning. This is what the Scriptures teach, that this is the work of the Messiah. Now, Mary wasn't going to see this in her lifetime. This is what Jesus will do finally and fully. He will do this on his return when he comes back at the end. But these two groups, the powerful who harm the weak and the weak who are harmed by the powerful, um, are are dealt with at the second coming, will be dealt with at the return of Christ. And make sure you understand this as you read your Bible and you read the scriptures. I'm going to show it to you from other passages because you may say, well, this isn't clear to me. I need to see this from somewhere else. So I'll show it to you from some other places. But the general idea is this, that when Jesus returns, let me put it this way, he will right every wrong. That's why, that is one of the reasons that this message, the message, the Christian message, is good news. It is good news. It is a glorious news that the Messiah, when he comes, is establishing justice. He is establishing justice, and he is taking care of those who are powerful, harming others. He will correct that. He will deal with that. Those who have been hurt by others, he will deal with that. He will correct that. That is what he's going to do on the last day. When Jesus returns, he will right every wrong. It's not just when Jesus returns, he will put us, some people in heaven and some people in the other place. There's some, the judgment day, the way the judgment, the last judgment is spoken of is, it's a time when all wrongs are righted. When all the wrongs are righted, when all harming, when all injustice will be fixed, will be righted on that day. Okay? And so that's the picture. So, for example, in the Bible, when judgment's talked about, or judging doesn't mean simply, I'm going to decide, it doesn't mean just the typical thing that we think of I'm going to decide the case. It means I'm going to correct, I'm going to fix the injustice. Everything that's out of order, everything that's wrong is going to be righted. And what that means is that there will be many Christians who are there on that day who have done wrong, and their wrongs will be dealt with. Their wrongs will be dealt with. It doesn't mean they'll be lost. It doesn't mean they'll be damned. It doesn't mean they'll be cast away, but it means in some way that God will bring justice. He will deal with the wrongs that they've done. Of course, he'll deal with unbelievers as well and the wrongs that they've done. But it's not true that because you put your faith in Jesus, if you've done terrible things, that won't be dealt with, that won't be taken care of, that won't be addressed by God. As your Father, Jesus as your Savior, but in the same way, it must be addressed, it must be dealt with. And that means, when we look back at our own lives and we look at Christians in history and we say, oh, Christians did this and Christians did that, but because they believe in Jesus, it doesn't matter, they get off scot-free. No, they don't. It will be dealt with. The day of judgment is the day of order being established, justice being reestablished in the universe, and everything will be put where it's supposed to be, and God will fix, through Christ, will fix everything and establish it the way it's supposed to be. Jesus will rescue the weak from the powerful, and he will establish justice, set everything in order. And even the harm, as I said, done by Christians will be exposed on that day, will be rebuked on that day, will be pulled down on that day. The damage of what you've done will be healed and will be set in order. You will be saved. You are forgiven. You will be saved. But what you've done will be set in order. And I am looking forward to that for the harm that I've done, actually. I want the harm that I've done to be dealt with. Now, you may not feel that way, but I feel that way. I have hurt people in my life, and I want Jesus, as he has died for my sins, he has forgiven me my sins, but I want him to put in order everything that I wrecked with my junk, with my evil, with my sin. The people that I, God's going to fix the junk that I did, the mess that I made, the problems that I have caused. He's going to heal that so that, when I see somebody in heaven who I've harmed, it won't be like this hasn't been dealt with. It will have been dealt with. It will have been addressed. It will have been taken care of. I don't know how that's going to happen, but this isn't something, it may take a long time. Who knows how long the judgment day takes. I don't think the day means it's 24 hours. It's probably some process that we go through, that God takes us through. We don't know how long it is or what it's all about. Now, let me read you some other passages. Now, listen to these passages in light of what I've just been saying. I'm sure some of you are saying, I don't buy any of this from what Mary said. So listen to this from just a few other passages, and then you can continue to read your Bible with this in mind and notice this. Whenever there's a passage about judgment, you'll see this kind of thing again and again. Psalm 72. What does Psalm 72 tell us about the Messiah? May he defend the afflicted among the people and save the children of the needy. May he crush the oppressor. May he crush the oppressor. For he will deliver the needy who cry out, the afflicted who have no one to help. What is the day of the Messiah? When the Messiah comes, the Messiah will right every wrong. He will pull down the powerful who have afflicted others, and he will raise up the needy of the earth. What else does it say? He will take pity on the weak and the needy, and he will save the needy from death. He will rescue them from oppression and violence, for precious is their blood in his sight. This is the day of the Lord. This is the day of Jesus coming, establishing order, establishing justice, establishing that everyone will answer. And so will answer for what they've done to others and the harm that they've done. Isaiah 11, he will not, listen to this, he will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, the Messiah. In other words, what that means is he won't just, take this person's word for it or what could be easily seen, what other people saw, what was seen. He will know. He will dive into the depths of the situations. He will know what is right. He will know what is justice. He will know what is evil and what is good and what needs to be done. And what we can do, we have court cases now, we have rulers now, and the justice they bring is, there's some good in it, but it's a lot of garbage. It's a lot of other, but they don't see it the way they should see it, and they don't bring true justice, but Jesus is going to see into every situation, know it exactly, and he will do what is right, what should be done, what needs to be done in this day to set the universe and set the world in order. He will do that. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness, he will judge the needy. Do you hear that? Now, when we hear judge the needy, we think he means he's disciplining the needy. That's not what it's saying. Judging is not necessarily a bad thing. Judging is establishing righteousness. It's establishing justice. So when it's saying he will judge with righteousness, he will judge the needy, you may hear that and go, why would the needy want to be judged? It's because he's by saying judging, he's saying he's going to help the needy. He's going to bring the righteous solution, bring the righteous answer. Okay, more here. He says, with justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. There will be wicked who will be slain on that day, who will be cast out on that day. And then remember this verse near the end of this section we read this morning. This is what Jesus is establishing. This is what he's going to establish when he comes back. This is what it will look like. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be filled, the whole earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Order will be established again. Harming and destruction and violence will end, and justice will be established. Ezekiel 34:20. Let me read you three more, and I'll read these a little bit quicker. Ezekiel 34:20. Therefore, this is what the sovereign Lord says to them. See, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. I will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Both sheep, both part of God's people, some fat, some lean. Now, this isn't talking just about, your girth or, your weight. This is talking about those who are wealthy, powerful, and infringing on the others and harming the lean ones, and there will be justice done. It will be corrected. And if you don't believe that, keep reading. What does he say? Because, speaking to some of them, you shove with your flank and your shoulder, butting all the weak sheep with your horns until you've driven them away. There is not justice being done among my people, God is saying. There is not justice being done. Some are hurting and harming others. Some have power, and they use that power to hurt and harm others. And this will not continue when God acts, when God does his thing. He will correct this. Even among his own people, he will correct this. Even among his own people, he will correct this. He says, I will save my flock, and they will no longer be plundered. They will no longer be plundered. I will judge between one sheep and another. What will he do in that day? I will place over them one shepherd. Who will that be? My servant David, meaning the Messiah in the line of David. And he will tend them, and he will tend them and be their shepherd. Revelation 20, verse 12. And I saw the dead, great and small. Notice that. Both the great and the small. Standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. But the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. There's a going over of the accounts of what you have done with your life, the way you have lived. And there's an addressing of that. There's not a, oh, you believe in Jesus, we don't need to look at this. No, that's not the way it is. And it's not so you can be damned and condemned, but there will be an assessment. There will be a judgment that takes place on that day, and people will answer. And this passage may be a mystery. I'll close with this passage. This passage may be a mystery to some of you that you've read it before, but listen to it in light of this. 1 Corinthians 3:12. And this is speaking about Christians, okay? So when he says, if anyone, he's about to say, if anyone, he means any Christian, okay? So listen to this. If anyone, any Christian, builds on this foundation, the solid foundation of Jesus Christ, if anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, or lesser things like this, wood, hay, or straw, and this is these last few things are examples of doing the wrong thing, of building on it in the wrong way. Their work, Christians, all Christians, listen to this, their work will be shown for what it is. It will truly be revealed. What they've done with their lives, the way they've lived, will be shown. It will be revealed. It will be exposed. It will be made clear. Whether they've done good, they've built with good material, or they've built with straw, they've built with lousy material, they've spent their life doing what they shouldn't have done, or at least done some things they shouldn't have done. It will be revealed with fire. Fire for Christians? Yeah, fire for Christians, to reveal their works, to test their works. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. Will test the quality of each person's work. If what has been built survives, it's good, this is really obedient to God, this is what God wants, the builder will receive a reward. Not meaning you get saved because of your works, but meaning God will bless and reward the good you've done. You're saved by Jesus apart from any merit or any work that you do. You could never get anywhere without Christ and without the forgiveness of sins. But there's a reward for the good things that we do in this life. God, and that could mean nothing more than God simply recognizes it and honors it and says, good job, well done on this. This is wonderful, what you did here by my grace. This is wonderful. But then it also says, but if your work is burned up, in other words, it was sin, it was evil, it wasn't what God wanted you to do. You were hurting others, you were harming others, you were failing God. The builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved, even though he will be saved only as one escaping through the flames. So this picture of some will come and they won't have very much to show God because of the evil that they've done in their life, and they will be saved, but the way they've spent their life will be burned up. Now that's a mystery. That doesn't really fit with pop Christianity, does it? That's not inside the simplistic mode that we have of thinking about these things. So I'm hoping I can get you to think about the last judgment in a different way. And I'm not doing this because I want to scare you or disturb you, because you are secure in Jesus Christ. We're not talking about damnation here. We're talking about I wanted you to tell you this was because I wanted you to see what's on Jesus' heart. I want you to see what's on Mary's heart and what's on Jesus' heart and what they care so passionately about. Mary wanted to see justice done. She rejoiced that the Messiah was coming because the Messiah was going to do good and set things in order. She wanted to see her son establish it as the prophets had foretold, Isaiah and many other prophets as well. And Jesus loves these things, and this is what he wants to do. Mary rejoices in this. Jesus rejoices in this. And we should rejoice in this as well. I know that what I've just presented to you, for many of you, you received it as, for some of you don't agree with it. That's probably true. And some of you may reject it and say it's bad news. I don't want to hear that. But it's not bad news. If you think about the things that happen in this world, the terrible things that happen in this world, we need a Messiah who's coming in to fix all of that, to set all that in order. And there are Christians in history, this is what we're focusing on today, we could talk about other things, but there are Christians in history and there are Christians this very day who are involved in things where they are harming other people, and they will answer for that to their Savior, to their Lord. They will answer for that. They will answer for what they've done. Jesus doesn't just say, oh, forget about the terrible things that you did. No, he addresses that, and he will set that order. That will be addressed, that will be dealt with, and that will be set in order in some way. I don't know how, but in some way it will be set in order. And so you need to understand that what the coming of Jesus, why it's good news, why it's glorious news, is everything that you know that is messed up in this world will be dealt with. It won't just be forgotten. We won't just have amnesia and forget all this happened. It will be dealt with. The books will be open. The books will be open, and what has taken place will be corrected. And so when we read in history about some, how could this Christian have done this thing? How could this European Christian have done this thing to the indigenous people in America? How could he have done that? How could he have done those cruel things? But he was a Christian, so we'll see him in heaven. No big deal. No big deal. He will answer. He will answer. Jesus will speak to him about it. Jesus is the one. Jesus is your Savior. He's also the judge. He will address it with him. He will address it. I don't know what Jesus is the only one who knows pure justice. He will deal with it and do what he needs to do there. But it will be addressed. It will be taken care of. The last judgment is the day when things are set in order. And so what all this means, what does this mean for us to take away? What can we take away? And we need to close out here. What can we take away as application? So what for you? Now what for us today? Is this just something to be aware of? Is it something to remember? Well, it needs to set our own lives in order and begin to think about our own lives. Christians should be the ones in the city. You know, in any city you're in, it should be the Christians who are the most concerned about the weak of the city and defending and protecting the weak of the city from those who have more power. It should be the Christians every time. We shouldn't need the government to be doing that. We shouldn't need these agencies to be doing that. That's what we should be doing. That's what we should be all about. We should be the ones in every city and every town. Whoever is weak, whoever is afflicted, Christian or not Christian, none of that matters. The ones who are weak and the ones who are afflicted are the ones. Those are the ones that we are to take care of. We have been given that duty and that responsibility. If we shirk that responsibility, we're basically rejecting Jesus' heart. We're rejecting what Jesus is all about. This is what Jesus is going to do. This is what Jesus wants to do when he returns. And so we can't perfect it. We can't make it exactly the way Jesus is going to do it. But we can take small steps. We can do things that we are able to do in our circle and in our influence to try to, wherever the weak are, to protect the weak from the powerful. The nature of human society, the nature of human life, is that some afflict others, some prey on others, some hurt others. And that is something that we should be on our heart. And so this theme is all through the scriptures, folks, and I just don't see it. I just don't see it in our popular Christian teaching. I just don't see this. And yet this is just the Bible. This is just what the Bible says again and again. Do you want to have a heart like Jesus' heart? This is, when I hear this, this is not bad news. This is good news. Jesus is fixing everything, and he wants to use me today to be a part of that in just a little way. And so what I want to ask you to do is this. what to take away. Now what? Now what are we going to do this week? What are we going to do? I want to ask you to do two things. I usually point you back to prayer because I think you need God's leading with this. And I want to ask you to pray two things, and I'm going to be praying the same thing with you. First of all, Lord, show me if I am... Many of you have different levels of power, different levels of influence and whatever. Lord, show me if I'm harming anyone. Show me if I'm harming anyone so that I may repent, stop, and fix it as best as I'm able to fix it. Remember, what did when Zacchaeus became a disciple of Jesus, what did he do? He stopped harming people, and he fixed it. He tried to pay back the people that he had harmed people. Economically, he had harmed people, and he stopped doing it, and he fixed it, right? He went back to those people, and he paid them money to try to make up for the harm that he had done for them. And so my first thing is pray, Lord, show me if I'm harming anyone. You may not know that you are today, but perhaps you are. I don't know that you are, but perhaps you are. Lord, in my life, if I'm harming someone, and it's probably going to be somebody weaker than you in some way. I don't know in what way, but in some way, it'll be someone weaker than you. Show me, and so I may repent, I can stop, and I can make it right. And then secondly, Lord, show me people that are being harmed by others. Show me a person or some people that are being harmed by others that I may help, that I may step in and do something to defend, that I may do something to rescue, that I may be a part of helping, that I may do Jesus' work. In imitation of the work that Jesus is doing through his kingdom, that I may do that work today, and that I may be involved in that. When I was thinking about this week, I said, let me think about this congregation, and let me think about some of the people who I know do this. And I started to write out names, and I had quite a long list, so I decided not to read the list. But there are people in our church. There are people in our church. I won't name them by name, but this is where their heart is, and this is the way they live, and they live for people who are weaker, who are being harmed for one reason or another, who are harmed by others, and they give their lives in many ways. They sacrifice for the benefit of others, to help others, to rescue them, to benefit them. And so this is happening already. This is something that's not, it's not that it's not happening. It is happening. But I want to encourage you to pray, Lord, show me if I'm harming one so I may stop and fix it. And Lord, show me people that are being harmed by others that I may help. And I mean you, often I say these sort of things and then I walk away and I say, I wonder what will come of that. And I never know. So I'm going to ask you, and I know most of you won't be comfortable with this, but I'm going to ask you to help me. This isn't bragging, okay? This is to help your pastor. Will you call me or email me or let me know when the Lord answers that and you obey the Lord? Will you do that? Let me know. Because I want to know. I want to hear about you hearing what is Jesus' heart, what Jesus is all about, which is justice and establishing order and rescuing the harmed and the oppressed and the afflicted and the weak and all the words that we saw in all those prophecies, including Mary's prophecy. And I want to hear about when that's bubbling up in our congregation and the Holy Spirit is taking the word and putting it in your heart and guiding you into obedience and you are actually obeying. I want to hear about that. I want to hear that the word of God has been active in our congregation. I want to hear that the Holy Spirit has worked in your heart and steered you into new obedience, new love for other people. And you have been able to help someone who's being harmed, or that you have stopped doing something that was harming someone. And you've turned your back on that, and you fixed the situation. You have tried to establish justice. Now, I know this is a weird Christmas sermon. I know this isn't what we typically think, but folks, I'm not on some tangent here. I'm not in the appendix ZZ here. This is the Word of God. This is straight theme right from the beginning to the end. This is what the Word of God is about. And the only reason you don't see it, some of us don't see it sometimes, is because we have on the blinders, I think, of this pop kind of Christianity, where we just don't see parts of the Bible. We just read past those things. We don't see what the Bible is actually saying in many, many places. How many times does the Bible tell us that God made all human beings, and when he looks at the world, he sees the human beings that are being hurt and afflicted by other human beings, and that enrages him, and that's not justice, and he wants to correct that. And now we know that the Messiah is being sent to correct that. And one day it will be. And this isn't like, oh, this is a side job. Evangelism is what's really important. But if you have a little bit of time, do this. No, this is obedience to God. Is loving your wife a side job? Loving your husband a side job? No. Is doing the work that God has given you that you make pay for your family, is that a side job? No. It's all. It's the calling of God upon our life. This is what it means. A Christian is someone who is supposed to see when people are being afflicted and respond and intervene and help in the many different ways. I didn't go into details. There's so many different ways, of course, to do this, from organizational and planning and systematic system type stuff to very personal interactions one-to-one. Let me close. I need to stop. So let me know. I guess, let me put it this way. Not only do I want to be encouraged, I want this week to hear about this and be like, yes, yes, the Spirit is working. The Word of God is working in this congregation. I was encouraged just by remembering all the things that this congregation has already done in the years behind. But I want to see that the Spirit is still working. But I also want to hold you accountable. I'm your pastor. This is the congregation that I've been given, and I need to hold you accountable. Is this? Are we going to do? Are we going to live this way? Are we all going to live this way? Is this what we recognize God has called us to be and to do? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your Word, Lord. I just want to rejoice right now. Apart from the application and all that, I want to rejoice. I want to set all that aside right now and just say thank you, Lord, that we have fouled up this world and we have fouled up the countries in which we live and fouled up the cities in which we live, and we have done so much harm. Good has been done as well, but so much harm has been done. So much destruction has been wrought. So much injustice in this world. And I want to thank you, Lord, that your son Jesus is coming and he will set all of it in order. Nothing will be missed. There will be no detail that is not addressed and fixed. Everything will be set in order. All things from history will be addressed. Anything that's taken place. Lord, I want to thank you for that you are truly going to make all things right and all things good. We're not just going to pass into some amnesia and forget it all, but you are going to fix it all and truly take care of it all. And what's going to be done is going to be justice. It's going to be right, righteousness, exactly the way it should be. I praise you for that. I thank you for that. That is the best thing that I can possibly imagine. And I know that my own sins have contributed, and yet I know that they're forgiven in Jesus, and I thank you for that. Thank you for dying on the cross to forgive me of my own sins, the way that I have failed and harmed other people. Forgive me, Lord. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for that, and thank you that you will address my own failings as well. Lord, do this work. We look forward to it. We rejoice in it. Father, I pray that you will help us to be faithful now to represent you well in this world, that if this is our Savior, if this is our Messiah, then we should look like him on a small scale and be interested and passionate about the same things. Lord, do this work in our hearts, we pray, and through us, through our bodies, through our hands, through our feet, through our minds, do this work. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please join with me as I lead us in this time of intercessory prayer. Is this on? Pull it close, okay. Father, we've come this morning in your name to pray and to sing your praises and to hear and study your word. We confess our sin and receive your faithful forgiveness by faith in Christ. And we feast on the preaching of the word and in the bread and wine. We edify one another in our prayers and fellowship, and we testify to the observing world that we are a people saved by grace and sanctified for Christ. This time is important to both our bodies and our souls for the health and building up of each. So thank you, Father, for the Lord's Day, for bringing your people into a preview of the established kingdom, for giving us this foretaste of divine glory. We cannot truly comprehend the nature of your established kingdom, but on the Lord's Day, we see it less hazily, and we know that it is wonderful and glorious beyond belief. As we wait, according to your will, we remember our responsibilities and duties. You've not created us to be idle. Before the fall, you give us dominion and responsibility, so labor and striving are not mere effects of the fall that can be or should be dismissed, but on the contrary, as strangers in a strange and fallen land, our work of spreading the gospel is magnified, and our obligation to love our neighbor is all the more crucial. And so we bring our prayers, knowing that the obstacles against us would not overcome us apart from your inspiration and your spirit dwelling in us. So we pray for our nation and her leaders, that they would prosper and flourish, for as nation prospers, so the church prospers. We pray for our nation and state's economies, that you would minimize the suffering from the pandemic and despair that an economic collapse would entail, and that you would raise up the church to deeds of mercy, faith, and generosity. We pray for your church, that in many and noble goals and objectives on which she focuses, she would not lose focus on the primary, the proclamation of the gospel of Christ, and the calling of sinners to run to Christ and his beauty and salvation. Grant our ministers your wisdom and discernment and strength for the day and faith in troubled times, that these men would be wise, patient, faithful, temperate, gentle, and above all, loving. Protect these men and their families and fit them for the challenges you give them. And we pray for each other, our brothers and sisters in Christ, that we would all be rich in Christ and that his complete work would be in the forefront of our minds, that we would not forget that the gospel, but we rejoice in it and cling to it passionately. And forgive us of our sins and meet us in our need. And we pray for the Gilder News and the Anons who are recovering from COVID, that you would be with them and continue to make them well. We give you thanks with gratitude for the life of Ruth Skates and the joy that came from being around her. Comfort her family during this time of grieving. We pray these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing hymn number 196, Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. Page 196.
Jesus, born to set thy people free.
Please be seated.
Come to this table, turning in my Bible to the Gospel of Matthew, the words of institution. This table is the communion table, the Lord's Supper, the bread and the wine, and you will find in front of you in the pew one of these that looks like something like this. The bread and the wine are in this. We're using these for the time being. And if you'll peel, before we get into it, if you'll peel off the very top layer, you'll expose the bread or the wafer there that you can use in just a moment. This sacrament is for the Lord's people. It is for all the Lord's people. If you're not a member of this church, but you have faith, true faith in Jesus, you've repented of your sins, you're a member of another church, you're baptized, you know, and you're a part of God's church. You don't have to be a part of this church to eat and drink. We do warn you that Paul gives this warning. And if you are living in sin without dealing with it, without confessing it and repenting of it, turning from it, we're all sinners. Every one of us has sinned this week, has sinned this day, and has things that we must be forgiven of by the work of Jesus again and again, day by day by day. But if you're living in some kind of sin that you haven't left yet, and you haven't acknowledged it or repented of it or addressed it with God, don't eat and drink, but instead today repent and deal with that today and speak to the Lord and come back to Him, return away from that and receive the forgiveness of what Christ has done for us. Let me pray, and then we will eat together. Father in heaven, we thank you for sending the Lord Jesus and your love for us. That we have all done wrong. We have all harmed others. We have all failed you, disobeyed you. And the Lord Jesus has provided for our cleansing, for our forgiveness. You have washed us of that sin. You have cleansed us of that sin by the work of the Lord Jesus. Jesus died for us. He gave himself on our behalf. His body was broken, his blood was spilled, and we give you thanks. We praise you for this work that has saved us, that has provided for our forgiveness, that we may now begin to turn and follow after you and live for you and worship you. We ask that you would set aside this ordinary bread and juice for this holy purpose, that this would be the communion of the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask that as we eat and drink in faith, looking to Jesus, you will spiritually strengthen us and nourish us as we eat and drink in faith. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body." If you'll open up your juice. Then Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Let's drink. Let's pray. Father, thank you once again for bringing us here today. Lord, the message today was hard, Lord. The message today was had some hard elements in it, and it was showing me my own sin and showing some of us our sin and calling us to repentance, calling us to obedience. But Lord, you are with us. There's no reason for us to despair or be discouraged by this because you are with us. You forgive us of our sins. None of our sins can hold us down or hold us back. You will go with us. You cleanse us of our sins by Christ's sacrifice, and you empower us by your Holy Spirit to live for you. You will work. This is not up to us, Lord. This is not something we could ever do. If your Spirit is in us, then you can give us your heart, your love for others. We can see others the way you see them, the way Jesus, the Messiah, sees them, the way Jesus saw them when he died on the cross. Father, you can show us your heart. Christ can live in us and live through us. And so we rejoice in that. Because of what Christ has done for us, we belong to you. Because of what Christ has done on our behalf, we are yours. And we can go from this place with the confidence that you are with us. No matter what we've done, no matter what our sins have been, you are cleansing us. You have cleansed us of those sins. You are taking us forward into this day and the life ahead. And that you can work through us. And that you will use us. And the time that we have left, whether it's 1 week, whether it's 1 year, whether it's 20 years or 50 years, Lord, you can use us for your purposes. You can show us your way. You can, by your Holy Spirit, work the fruit of the Spirit through us, love and joy and peace and patience and kindness. Do this work in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. The offering plate is not passed during the service, but it is in the back. There's a box back there where you can put your gift or your offering in that box for the church or for the needy. If it's for the needy, mark it as such. Will you stand and receive the Lord's blessing? This is God's word of blessing on his people. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, which means his unmerited favor, though we are sinners, that we have done much that is wrong, that we have good grace that comes through Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. We need to make any announcements before we break here for the day? Anyone need to make an announcement? Let me announce two things. There is going to be, because I know not all of you see the emails or notice those, we are going to have a Christmas Eve service this year.